Young Song, who has done most of the heavy lifting, I would say. Nick Bruscia, Chris Romano, Brian Parker, and me. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Annette LeCuyer. Why talk about facades? While digital technology permeates every aspect of building design and construction these days, the element of architecture that has been most visibly transformed is the building envelope. The facade has become a platform for architectural innovation, which may be categorized into two broad domains: enhancement of building performance and experimentation with image. Thinking about these two domains, performance and image, our sense in this group of faculty that has organized this event, our sense is that most critical attention is directed towards building performance. And perhaps this is not surprising, given the growing emphasis on energy, life cycle costing, and sustainability. So a couple of examples serve to illustrate this point. When the Sears Tower in Chicago, designed by SOM, was completed just over 50 years ago, it was, at 108 stories, the tallest building in the world. And it boasted many technical innovations, not least its bundle tube structure. However, it was also single glazed, which was the standard practice at the time. Following recent renovations that included an entire new envelope, among many upgrades, it now consumes 80% less energy than previously. A similar tale emerges from Louis Kahn's Kimball Art Museum, which was completed in 1972, which you see on the left, and the extension by Renzo Piano that opened last year. The new extension uses half the energy of the original building. So these examples are not intended to be criticisms of either SOM or Kahn, but simply to illustrate the way in which building performance, and particularly the performance of the building envelope, has dramatically improved through implementation of both higher standards and new technologies. But we all know that building facades are about more than mere technology. The digital design and fabrication techniques that are transforming the facade are not ends in themselves, but instruments for the creation of cultural phenomena, identities, and memories. So consequently, this evening, as we focus on the facade, we will consider how we look at it and what it is that we see, what it is that the facade is telling us, as well as how it is made. Throughout history, the facade has been instrumental in conveying political and economic power and in fostering cultural tahit, cultural interaction, and cohesion. There are many examples of facade imagery that have migrated across cultures and have been appropriated and transformed. So in the early 19th and early 20th centuries, for example, neoclassical iconography was widely applied to American civic buildings and institutions, like this public library in California, this Carnegie Library. And these institutions were seeking to associate flowering of American culture with the achievements of the Greeks some 2,000 years earlier, simply by association. However, at that same time, Louis Sullivan began to look outside Western culture for his inspiration. And so he looked at things like this, Islamic decorative motifs. And so when he came to design the terracotta facade of the Guernsey building downtown, it became a prime example of this inspiration that he had found outside the neoclassical tradition. This facade was a technical tour de force, the first building to be completely clad in terracotta, which offered a number of practical advantages. It helped to fireproof the frame, it was lighter in weight than stone, and it was malleable, so formable. And terracotta was not a new material, it was an ancient material, transformed by technology. But the facade of the guarantee is also what Sullivan called a garment of poetic imagery. He appropriated Islamic motifs, in particular, nature disciplined by geometry, to signify the individualism so important to democracy. So more than 100 years later, this transformation of imagery and meaning is particularly poignant in our current global cultural context. Sullivan also described the facade of the guarantee as a magical tattoo. And the idea of the tattooed skin makes a further appearance in Herzog and de Meuron's Eberswold Library. Photo-etched concrete, a process invented for this project, produced a building skin that is laden with cultural associations across history, ranging from frescoes that historically communicated important cultural stories to illiterate populations, to Andy Warhol's serial pop imagery. And it has to be said that this building is sited in former East Germany. It was built in the 1990s, just after the Berlin Wall came down. And one of the images, which is engraved in the facade, is this very famous photograph of East Berliners escaping to the West. This is a photograph that was widely recognized around the world. And you see it here now in these four bands of the building facade. And with a sliced image of the Reichstag through the middle of the image. So suddenly this facade now becomes very politically charged. Similarly, metal facades, ranging from cast iron to the curtain wall, have embraced both technology and imagery. So this facade, the cast bronze facade of the Museum of American Folk Art, was completed by Todd Williams and Billy Chen in 2001. And now, this year, it has sadly been demolished. But it located cultural meaning in the fabrication process itself, utilizing a direct and intentionally primitive method of making, closely aligned with the primitive art housed in the museum. So molten bronze was cast directly on the foundry floor in order to capture the floor's cracks, fissures, and imperfections. In this way, the handcrafted culture embodied in the facade stood in stark contrast to the perfection of the industrial sublime that Mies van der Rohe had sought just a few blocks away in Manhattan in that other famous bronze facade of the Seagram building. So as in the past, architects today seek to deploy technologies at their disposal to address not only the environmental performance, but also the cultural performance of the facade. So our speakers this evening, based upon their own intense scrutiny of facades that they are designing for very diverse environmental and cultural settings will offer a range of views that will help us to begin to think about how hard technologies are being deployed to enhance the soft cultural attributes of the building envelope. So again, we welcome you and we look forward to your active participation in the conversation. It's great to see a full house. And so I would like to ask Jin Young Song now to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, Annette. Thank you, everyone, for coming to the symposium this evening. It has been my honor to organize this special event together with Nick Bruscia, Brian Carter, Annette LeCuyer, and Chris Romano. On the subject of the facade, we have exchanged many ideas and suggestions during the time leading up to this event. I want to say that it has been a fantastic experience to work with all of these organizers. In addition, we deeply appreciate the support provided by the School of Architecture and Planning, with thanks to Robert Shively, Dean of the School, and Omar Khan, the Department Chair, Also, we must give sincere thanks to, Boston Valley Jacora, which does medals in the Humanities Institute of United University at Buffalo for generously supporting this event. We deeply appreciate your contributions. The journalist asked the Honey's project before and after examines the standard of beauty across cultures on the global level. She contacted nearly 50 individuals from more than 28 countries and sent a photo simply asking, make me beautiful. As a cosmetic level of modifying the face, these images represent many cultural constructs of beauty. And these superficial changes made by Photoshop begin to touch upon the fundamental aspect of personality, character, cultural value, and the meaning of beauty. Digital culture has made possible the manipulation of such social and cultural agendas at the cosmetic level. These readings of the face exactly coincide with the subject of the symposium today, which is the facade. The face of the building is an intrinsic issue of architecture. As with the work of Esther Honig, digital culture has given us tremendous power to experiment with the materiality and the message of the facade. So the focus of this a seminar, which was conducted last semester, entitled Façade As, you can see on the first floor of this building, was to examine the full potential of what the building façade can do to us. We searched for façade throughout the history of architecture that have achieved a certain level of autonomy, free from the market and free from banal social forces. For example, Hawa Mahal, called the Palace of Wind, showed us the facade that concealed the true identity of the building for the purpose of allowing the occupant behind the facade the freedom to look from within without being seen from outside. More than 200 years later, Skidmore and Zermelo has designed a hospital in Abu Dhabi utilizing parametric design tool and complex metal fabrication. This project aimed to have the same function as our earlier example, concealing the program inside while providing a free views to the outside. Facade as ecology is a theme that has only emerged recently. The Animal Wall by Gita Schumentner and the Bed Tower of our own faculty, Joyce Wang, show generative ecology in the built environment, not by adding superficial elements such as the green wall, but by integrating ecology into the conceptual roots of construction. We also explore the concept of facade as branding. In some cultures, a literal translation of brand to facade establishes the facade as figure. In other cultures, the facade utilizes more sophisticated tactics to convey the message. And of course, facade is used as propaganda in a certain society. As a prologue to this evening's discussion, we should acknowledge scholarly works investigating ornament. Rashid Mousavi and Michael Krugel have argued for the return of ornament as an expression of the convergence of architecture and culture. Antoine Picon examines the operation of history on the agency of architecture, searching for the essential meaning of art and architecture, addressed by ornament. Alejandro Zaira Polo locates the design of the building envelope at the center of politics, the shift of economic power, and hybridization of cultural differences. With respect to these great minds, I want to emphasize again how Esther Honig's before and after project managed to touch upon the essential issue of beauty. It is the fully culture we are living in to affect our disciplinary practice in architecture. Architects have the unprecedented power of parametric modeling together with material and manufacturing innovation, all of which allow us to manipulate perception. In light of this, how should this power be used in the design of the facade. What can the building facade tell us? Can the facade address contemporary social political issue? Can the facade trigger cultural memories? Can the facade shape cultural identities and reflect collective values? More importantly, what is the role of the new technologies in this task? So in this symposium, we are asking these questions about the building facade of practitioners rather than searching for another theoretical framework. Tonight we have the leadership renowned architecture firms, Morphosis, SHoP, Ski Bones and Mail, and later in the semester on April 22nd, Sauer Gutten from Berlin, all of whom have produced a project with global impact using most advanced technologies. So let's get started. Our first speaker is Stan Tsu. Stan Tsu is a senior architect at Morphosis Architects, where he served as office-wide lead on facade fabrication and technology. Mr. Tsu's recent project include the Hanking Center Tower in Shenzhen, China, and the first academic building for Cornell University's new tech campus on Roosevelt Island. As a former lead architect at Gary Partners, he worked on the Foundation Louis Vuitton Museum in France and the Guggenheim Abu Dhabi Museum. He holds a Bachelor of Architecture and Bachelor of Fine Arts degree from Rhode Island School of Design. Please welcome Stan Tsu.
Projects to show to you, as you say, I'm focused on facades at Morphosis. We're a collection of about 50 professionals, and under the leadership and spiritual guidance of Tom Maine. And so, without any delay, here we go. The first project that I brought was a corporate campus in Shanghai, and this project was an ideal project for the office in the sense that it really allowed for a sort of manifestation of a lot of the social and cultural experiments that Tom was doing with his artwork. Here is a drawing which eventually ended up in the forms of lithograph as well as model hybrids, which we call drawdles, which were half models, half drawings. And really what I think Tom was really experimenting with looking at was really the idea of representation, and the different types of modes of representation that we use. And essentially, even though this is a 2D flat object, you know, this is really more an exploration in sort of space and carving away. This is an exploded diagram of the giant campus. The system organization had a top, this is the essentially the building, which is the object of sort of the composition here. It's about 25% of the actual building, which is above ground. And you see here in green, this is the landscape, which actually was sort of 75% of the sort of project, and that 75% of the program was actually beneath here. There's a circulation spine here, which at times came and touched the building, at times was free, and at times actually submerged down underneath the surface into the building. A series of eggs or objects here peppered throughout the site, and at times they're actually objects. At times they are actually voids or programmatic spaces that serve to sort of further define the space underneath here. This is a diagram showing the different systems that were employed. We have the east-west sort of partitions here, the northwest partitions, the objects, as we call them, the building proper, which housed the offices for the campus. Here is the area which we call the head and the tail. There's a big metaphor for the dragon. I think the Chinese really like sort of the narrative and sort of the metaphors in the narrative. And you can see here the spine, which is the major circulation thoroughfare. spaces here end up being sort of these communal spaces throughout the building, different functions, gymnasium, library, and essentially the spine is sort of walking through this site, and touching upon these different spaces for to sort of create these moments of sort of congregation and gathering. Here you can see how the plinth, or actually the roof here is a landscape. Much of the program is underneath. We have a 32-meter cantilever here where the head of the building cantilevers over the lake. And you see, once again, where there isn't a need for a program, the building actually comes down and touches the true ground. So there's actually further sort of interrogation about what is the ground plane and sort of playing with the figure graph of the plan organization. Once again, a diagram showing the amount of program which is actually beneath the ground proper. This green roof really served as a sort of a sustainable feature in the sense that it reduces the heat load that comes down into your building. And as well, it serves to manage a lot of the stormwater runoff. Some other sustainable features included the double skin in the building proper, as well utilizing the lake for cooling for the heat plant, mechanical plant rather. So here we see the structural steel model from the Chinese contractor, and all the members are essentially set out as offsets from our design surface. Here you can see the model of the structure of the building proper, and then here our actual design surface, which is overlaid onto their model. This is a picture of the sort of tail of the building as one enters the site. One would enter from the far end here, which takes you to the highway to Shanghai. Essentially, all of the cladding has been organized only in a few different types of materials, and that being glass and Swiss pearl, and then the garden roof and concrete. And here you see a sort of, this is a photo of the actual steelwork of this cantilever, which is about a 32-meter cantilever, which in order to achieve this is actually a large member. If you can think of it as like a large truss of member, which has a backspan in order to allow for this canopy. Here's another view up through the canopy. You can see in this instance, we actually don't have any program within the building, but one can start to see the hierarchy of structure and secondary structure, which eventually the cladding is attached to. Here you see how the circulation spine is completely detached from the building, but is supported here out of the cantilever. Some more views of the circulation spine and how it at times engages the building and at times is fully separated. The glass here was all low wiring glass, floor to ceiling, no vertical mullions, so the idea was for just ultimate transparency in that. This is a study model of the double skin, the Swiss pearl assembly. And so essentially Swiss pearl is a cementitious concrete fiber board. And the reason for the choice of using this rather than metal was the fact that the material, if needed to, could be worked in the field to accommodate any sort of construction tolerances that weren't met, or any sort of odd conditions. You see the Swiss pearl here on the, Swiss pearl on the outer here, a actual weather wall or stud frame wall that is a steel substrate as a vapor barrier on the outside, a gyp interior finish, and then set off by a very large cavity. So this ends up being very effective sort of buffer, let's say, a thermal buffer for the different temperatures on the outside and the inside of the building. This is a close-up of the Swiss pearl cladding. You can see that we have exposed rivets here. This is the typical detail for the system, and you know, one of the reasons why it's flexible in the nature of how one installs it. This is a close-up of the concrete work there. And just regionally, in all the projects, we sort of have to consider what the skill set is and what the strengths are of the sort of construction team. And the cast in place quality was not of the utmost precision. So yet another way that we dealt with that was to play off of that and use an exposed board form finish. These are panelization drawings, which eventually went into the tender set, sort of laying out all of the different panels of Swiss pearl. And here we have a view of this landscape surface and an exhibition hall beneath in this particular instance. At times, these POB objects were actually hiding structure that was obviously necessary for holding up this space. But one can see that on the top is a completely green roof. On this particular view, the section is exposed. And once again, we have a highly transparent glazing system. In this case, a structural glass fin wall on patch beams. This is a view of this garden roof, which you know, is actually a highly technical sort of feature, in the sense that all of the sort of interface between one system and another creates opportunities for leakage, opportunities for detailing from a visual standpoint. So there's an awful lot of complexity in this very simple sort of partie diagram. Here you see the insulation in blue that's laid on top of a structural concrete slab, which is on top of a structural steel structure. The drainage mats are then bolted on, and then they have the actual soil medium for the green roof that is then poured on top. This is a sort of developed drawing showing the different parts of one of these cone objects. And so here you can see the steel tree, which is the structural support for the roof itself, and the different sort of set out dimensions in the sort of method of how we envision the geometry to be further developed into the next stage of tender set drawings. This is a view of one of the cones again. The circulation spine now has become part of the sort of interior surface, space rather. And here in the gymnasium, it almost appears as if this is an exterior space, but this is all a conditioned space. And once again, you see sort of these interstitial spaces that are created by these sort of juxtapositioning of elements. Construction photo here showing the secondary steel required for the GFRG or glass fiber reinforced gypsum. Here's a photo of the interior space of the exhibition hall. And once again, the sort of structural glass fin supported wall for maximum transparency. And you get these really, really nice sort of effects of the light and the reflections of these forms as they're sort of expressed in the actual fenestration of the facade, as well as at other times they become actual objects within the space. Some views of the GFRG panels, which can be sort of finished in a sort of a manner very similar to drywall. And so these structures actually occur on the outside as well. And in these instances, we use GFRC, or glass fiber reinforced concrete, for the weathering requirements. And here you see the sort of reflective glass on this side of the exhibition space, which starts to create some interesting sort of views with the sort of building behind. Again, one of the objects with the lighting and sort of the expression of this plane is the folded garden roof is expressed through the underside of the soffit with sort of metal mesh ceiling, which actually penetrates through and creates the interior ceiling at times. Another view of sort of the gym area. Here we have the pool. So the set out of a lot of these in the plan are very much compositional. And at times when moving into sectional qualities, you'll see how the facade then starts to take on the sort of sloped condition, and it's not necessarily what we would envision as, you know, the typical glazed wall or such. It's actually becoming more of a roof now and blending in with the garden. You'll see a skylight, another sort of puncture into the garden roof above. Another one of the cone objects here in the lobby, which we use polycarbonate, suitable for the exterior use as well for its UV stability, but obviously here for the sort of translucent quality of it. And once again, one of the cone objects, which is in the sort of interior space of the building. This is the sort of last slide I have on this project, which is the showing the head of the building, which is cantilevered over the lake here. You see here within is a conference room, which has a structurally laminated glass floor. And once again, to sort of create some sort of connection visually with the landscape. This next project is Emerson College in Los Angeles, which was just opened last year. And this building is a pretty small building, which we had to cram in a lot of program. But what was really important to the client is sort of creating a really signature sort of landmark building for their institution. This is Sunset Boulevard in Hollywood, and a very prominent sort of active thoroughfare through Hollywood. And this is in sort of showing the diagram of how the program was oriented. And essentially what we have is in the middle, more social and sort of dynamic and sort of gathering program. There's a large outdoor courtyard in here, which is occupied by these constructs, which are essentially the academic buildings. The red here you see are the dorms and below the parking. So really sort of pushing the more support, so to speak, program out to the outside and opening up the courtyard. The building was LEED Gold, using PVs to get about 50% of the hot water demand for the building. As well, we sort of got points for managing the stormwater runoff, as well as reducing water usage. And then energy optimization was sort of the main drive for the LEED qualification. And here we see a diagram showing some notions about natural ventilation that we had through the dorms, these clear daylighting paths through the building, and sort of the landscaping down low to take care of the stormwater management. And these are physical models. A lot of the different iterations that we did. This is the view from Sunset, and the photo below is actually the roof shot of each one of these versions. So we work a lot, you know, obviously in digital tool sets, but digital printing at times is really helpful for quickly iterating different massing studies. And, you know, we will do visual mock-ups and any sort of construction that helps to investigate what the given problem is. And so it's not always just a very linear process. So this is a view of the Emerson College from the sunset thoroughfare here. So you can see how the building is completely opened up north-south. This west-facing wall of the dorms actually has louvers to deal with the reliable sun at certain times of year. And then you can barely see a highly activated sort of dynamic, parametrically driven scrim just beyond. Sort of the view up through the courtyard, you have these like very tall interstitial spaces that occur. And this is almost a dialogue between the different sort of programmatic elements of the dorm, the academic building, and then the see the screen just in the foreground here is the roof of the academic construct. And just beyond, you can almost make out this tree, which is in a way a play as far as sort of like interaction of the different elements in physical form. So you can see that the scrim here is almost as if it's reacting to this sort of object here in the courtyard. And over here, there's a moment where the bridge penetrates in, and then the same sort of play is going on with that there. The scrim is completely exterior. It is essentially that. It is a shading device just beyond a whole wall of entrances for the dorm. And really, I think what Tom and the team here were looking to do is to really activate it, not in the very physical sense like it's doing here, in the literal sense of activating the surface, but really what that light and dark is doing as far as playing onto the surface beyond. Here you see sort of one of these little interstitial spaces, which in this sense was a grand stair. And the idea was to sort of create these areas for gathering, sort of social interaction. And here's a good shot of that sort of play between the screen and this back dorm wall. Bridge, which actually penetrates into the building. Here, the scrims here are actually made of 8-inch painted aluminum plate. The whole system is hung off of floor-to-ceiling aluminum tubes, which are slip-jointed at each floor to allow for movement and thermal expansion. All of these little pedals or wings are attached with pop rivets. So the construction is very, very, very simple. All the complexity was really front-end design. And I think at the end of the day, this thing came out to like $45 a square foot, which I think a typical rain screen that's insulated might be somewhere up around, say, like $100 a square foot once you get everything in there. Yet another one of the interstitial spaces between the dorm and academic building. And here's a mock-up that we really kind of, after we sort of decided what the pattern should be, one-to-one mock-ups were made to sort of just make sure for the visual quality of the wall. In this case, there was no performance mock-up that was needed. Everything was sort of proven in calculation that it would stand up structurally. And so there was no need for water infiltration tests. This is a view of sort of the object that housed the classrooms, a view from sunset. So it almost becomes almost like a very cinematic effect to what one would see in the street. And just to the right, a view of one of the more normative sort of spaces that we have in the courtyard. And this is a view of sort of the guys at Zener. We worked with Zener in developing this prefabricated system, which clad the sort of academic building. And here what you see is a prefabricated framework, which is sheathed with exterior sheeting and then eventually skinned with waterproofing. Here with sort of a mock-up to see how the joinery resolves itself on the corner. In the end, these panels did not come out to site fully clad. There were issues with sort of the shipping with them being fully clad, and so like, the decision was made at the end to sort of site install these pieces. But once again, it's sort of through close collaboration with the contractor that you start to develop these different systems for the final construction. Some shots of one of the larger panels coming in, flying in, and actually really having to use a 3D model to stage where these guys are getting picked up, where they're being dropped, and so on and so forth. So it's almost like a sort of 4D process where you sort of have to sort of consider time as far as the construction schedule and whatnot. Some panelization drawing for the ZEPS panel at Zener. And final shot of sort of entrance at night. I'm doing on time. So this one, this last project is a tower that we're doing in China, and so it's in process. And right now we're at the tender stage of the project, meaning it's about to get packaged up and go out to bid. And it's been a very interesting sort of process working on this project, in the sense that the client is a very, very sort of a conservative organization. It's a bank, and you know, there's a lot of the sort of typological and cladding approaches and desires of the design were not things that necessarily the client wanted to do. So I think there's a lot of victories in this design, which kind of stem from a lot of strategy, as well as being able to sort of work with the client and better understanding the design. This project was actually a result of a competition. And then what ended up being was it ended up evolving into an actual tower project. And so this is the pre-schematic design. There were notions of sort of really challenging the idea of transparency. And so like in many office buildings, all we sort of focus on is the maximum level of transparency views, and then you know, just how to view this thing as sort of a transparent glass box. And immediately Tom was sort of questioning, you know, what is the driver for that? Why are these, you know, thought to be transparent objects? That was some earlier studies of fritted glass, in the sense of trying to interpret what that first image was, and how could we do that when considering different constructions, different materials, and so forth. Further on in DD, we started to get to this imagery of a sort of topography that eventually really sort of influenced the way the cladding was developed. The tower itself is highly activated at the ground level, and I think these came from real sort of desires for the project to become more of like a sort of a connection to the city beyond. And so like the landscape became a very integral part as far as the way people engage the site. Majority of the site is covered in water, which has a very strong sort of metaphorical meaning in the Chinese culture. And challenging sort of even notions of how one enters the building. Programmatically here we have sort of a bank down low, and all of the sort of public functions of the bank. One would actually descend down and enter up through a staircase onto the first level, at which point you would either go to the bank functions or you would travel up the tower to the office proper. This is an earlier scheme. Things have sort of evolved from that, and we'll see shortly. And so once again, we're still thinking about the glass and, you know, what's the next step, and as far as realizing sort of the materialized form of this tower facade. Here you see a red ceramic dot grid, which is applied by sort of real similar to like a dot matrix printer. What you have directly on the back of the red dot is a black dot, and the notion of that was to sort of create higher visibility as you're looking out. So this is a view from the interior looking through that insulated glass unit. And really what the black dots do is sort of cancel out that glare. It sort of lets your eyes adjust to the sort of the environment outside for better visibility. And this is one thing where the client was absolutely adverse to that. Any notion of sort of something getting in the way of their view was an incredible challenge. And so we figured, well, we've already got a lot of louvers here covering all the views, so we might as well get rid of the red glass. And really what we went to in the final version was a highly reflective low-E coating, which in the end would is meant to reflect sort of the texture of these brisole elements on the outside. So this is where we are now in contender. We have a very highly normative sort of mid tower, very sort of activated lower end top portion where the strands, as we call them, start to evolve and change. The construction of this zone, and this zone are very different. And so even though it seems like a very simple sort of cladding approach, it's actually quite complex in the sense that in the end, the design intent is to have this reed as a very monolithic sort of tower. You see there's the different zones here, the top and the bottom, the highly normative middle, and all within this would be a glass enclosure, essentially your thermal and moisture barrier to the outside, your curtain wall proper. This is a pretty telling drawing as far as, this is as if you were to remove the cladding and just look at the glazing. So what you see here is in the light, the light is actually spandrel zone or opaque. The one major feature about this building is that it is not a central core tower, but it is a split core tower. So in a sense, in order for the tower to get this structural stability at height, you know, all of these towers, we rely on cores and serve as actual structural stability as well as mechanical sort of pathways for different services. In this case, it again played into the notion of why are typologically towers always built this way? And the one benefit from splitting this out is the fact that you now start to have more of an open floor plan to work with. Here you see the cladding and even in the fact that the cladding is actually starting to respond to the program. These are some of the working drawings that we're doing. This is at the tower, so we have some VIP functions up here. Essentially, this is a rooftop garden over here. This is a, this is an interior office here with the skylight. This is a part of an exterior space here, and as well here. These elements create programmatic spaces, but as well, they serve as sort of a signage element. Glass for the tower itself. And this is a wall section plan and elevation of the highly normative zone of the tower. And here you have a fairly standard unitized curtain wall, which is hung from the floors. And what the brise-soleil is doing is essentially attaching to points that are affixed to the curtain wall system. In this case, the joints of the building in the mid zone are aligned with the glazing joints to facilitate sort of installation and whatnot. Obviously, by design, we would probably not want these joints aligned because of just the necessity of efficiency at a certain height and sort of align those. And so you can see here a close up. Plan cut through the curtain wall, the brise-soleil, and the framing. You see the sort of structure reaching out to grab the curtain wall there. This is at the top and bottom, where now the system, even though it looks somewhat the same from the outside, clad in ultra-high performance concrete, these objects are actually flipping in the sense of their structural role to the curtain wall. You can see here tube steel, which creates a truss, which essentially spans from column to column. And then what's actually happening is that the glass is actually suspended or supported off of the brise-soleil elements themselves. So there's a bit of acrobatics in the sort of blending of the two systems and sort of creating this sort of cladding system, yeah, exterior. So once again, you see a close-up, the truss frame secondary steel going to the primary columns, and then the glazing system and sort of insulated exterior wall construction being suspended off of the brise-soleil itself. Some views of the more articulated base with the canopy, which is covered with water. So it's been pretty interesting to sort of push this material through design in the sense that ultra-high performance concrete does not exist in China as a sort of industry material. Some of the makers of that material here in Pittsburgh is one, we have a US-based company called Tactile. Another one is in France by Lafarge called Ductile. And Lafarge owns about 60% of all concrete sort of commodities worldwide. They're a very large producer. And by a sort of stroke of fortune, it came to be that Ductile decided to open up production in China. And so we may actually be able to get ultra-high performance concrete up onto this building. There's some details of the sort of glazing at the lobby, the highly transparent area, and sort of the waterproofing interface that has to go on to achieve these sort of reflecting pool roofs and different garden roofs and different assemblies. All of these have to be documented and sort of vetted. And what you see here, I think in the level of development, is almost something we'd see in 100% CD, but because of the interaction of the Chinese team and our lack of influence, potentially, once this gets built, we really strive to sort of really define what the systems are and the geometry through the 2D drawings. The BIM model was not a deliverable in a contract, but in this day and age, somebody's going to ask for it in the end. We're prepared to sort of use the model in developing drawings like this, which are essentially panelization drawings showing the light panels at the top, mid, and lower of the building. This is a drawing that Tom and a few guys did, which were essentially really talking about the way that the exterior of the building would now move into the interior. Earlier versions of the lobby had a sort of object, as it were, that created its own space and also created space around it. So now the design as it is, we've sort of gotten rid of the object to sort of express the void by bringing the material into the interior. These are some early preliminary studies of the view as one approaches the lobby from beneath and sort of the dynamic structure. Cutaway model showing the current scheme, the interior strands which penetrate into the building, the canopy elements, and then the sort of landscape reflecting pool prints that surround the site. Another building exploded axonometric showing the lobby strands and the sort of exterior components pulled away. So in close, this is a drawing that we sort of developed, an unfolded elevation showing all four sides of the building and sort of trying to express the complexity of the facade, even in this in the sectional quality. It looks quite basic, but really what you see is this sort of layering of different functions of the building within, at times seeing the core, louvers, at times actual having glass there, or potentially metal for shadow box. And so this is a main topic. Thank you so much.
Tower in Korea and Kelly Center in Hong Kong. Samir teaches at the Pratt Institute in Brooklyn and at the University of Pennsylvania in Philadelphia. He has a degree in architecture from the University of Pennsylvania and CMPD, Ahmed Stavet, India. He's a registered architect in New York State and in India. Please welcome Samir.
Everyone. like to sort of start out on a note, say that there is a lot that should be talked about, and especially in an academic setting, there should be a lot of imagery that can help in conveying certain points that I'd like to make today. But we are working on a few projects, especially the ones that I wanted to show today, which we could not get approval from our clients to share a lot of imagery. So I would like to apologize for that and try and compensate with words as far as possible. So SHoP is a firm based in New York City. I joined SHoP less than a year ago as the director of social design, which essentially is Façade. And before that, I have been working with the design of building enclosure systems for maybe 14 years now. So, SHoP finds itself at a time when it identified itself as a company that really wanted to bridge across what it saw as a division between architects who were building and architects who were talking about architecture, teaching about architecture, but not really building. And it is one of the things that comes back in our conversations at the office pretty regularly about how it is something ingrained in the way we work and the way we try to accomplish architecture is that it be informed by everything that is relevant to us, regardless of whether it falls within one category or the other. The idea of an informed construction, a construction that is, or a form or an entity that is closely in harmony with what it is trying to do, whether natural or man-made, the idea of appropriating materials and methods to fulfill certain specific purposes. These are not new ideas. They have been around, and SHoP is pretty much, it is very consciously continuing traditions that have existed for a very, very long time. I think that the idea of looking at craft and art from the point of an aesthete as much as the point of a problem solver is inherent in what we try to do. I don't know if you're familiar with the word techne, which is a Greek word, which is the root of both architecture and technology, which really is, it gets simplified as craft, but it is a little more. It is craft with a level of informedness that it can become an art, which I think is quintessential to what I am interested in and that I try to pursue through my work. So SHoP, for the most part, operates within the realm of a traditional architectural practice, but it always tries to take on a little more than what traditional architectural practices would limit us to. So we'll touch on some of these issues. SHoP was identified as one of the innovative companies in 2013 by Fast Magazine, and it's a matter of pride. We are currently working with several important clients, etc. And coming to the conversation about facades, which I just wanted to include these few slides to set the theme of what I would like you to try and thread together in the images that follow. Things that are important to us that come up constantly in our internal design coming back to materials that that you know when the building enclosures started becoming more and more industrially produced, and you know certain materials that were not as industrial were sort of left behind, and you saw an emergence of more. I think Seagram building, the image that was shown earlier, was an example of the beginning of that. And there is a real desire to once again expand the palette of materials that we work with, regardless of you know how common or uncommon it might be. There is a clear desire to engage in the actual thinking of how something is put together. It is something that, as architects, we are enabled greatly by technology and the access to certain kinds of tools that are now available, and this how technology is starting to bridge the processes of thinking and constructing across architecture and sort of the building industry, etc. So I think that there is definitely a desire to exploit that possibility. The idea of variation and repetition, it is something that is, of course, not unique or new, but again, as a potential for seeking seeking meaning in what we are doing. And the idea of fitness, I think that a large part of the materials that we are using today are flat materials. Flatness is inherent in most of the things that we work with. We think that there is more to be gained by trying to work against this flatness, both in terms of environmental responses as well as in terms of visual interest in what we do. The story of SHoP and this presentation both start with this project, which was what put SHoP on the map, which was the first PS1 MoMA competition back in 2000 that was won by SHoP, where they basically built this pavilion out of timber, and it was in a way the introduction of these ideas that are now festering in much more significant way. But I think the team sort of started concretizing certain ideas from that point, which is why it is important to go back here. And again, here we have a material which is very familiar. What was not very familiar at that time were drawings like this. This is basically the set of entire construction drawings. This one digital model, which had taken a set of surfaces and sectioned them several times over. These are layouts of actually paper printouts that were made on large format printers and taken to the site, and each line basically represented a section. One of these printouts represented about 1 meter width of this surface, and basically the team, the people who drew this, they would print it and then go to the site and they start cutting pieces of wood and start putting it together. So it was an extremely low-tech expression of relatively unusual surface geometry, etc. For its time, it was quite heartbreaking. And I think it sort of set the tone for what's to come. They did, this was a huge success in itself, and then they took this idea and applied it to, sorry about the font, which seems to not show up correctly, but it was applied to a building that should say Hangul Bok. happened at a time when there was relative, I would say, nervousness with the housing market, and I think a few partners at SHoP ended up becoming investors to accomplish this project. So they were definitely taking unusual, making an, or doing unusual experiments with the definition of the role of architect and trying to stretch it in different directions. Again, here the project was clad in zinc. It was zinc has been around as a material, also as a side panel. So in a way, the idea to use dark format zinc, dark colored zinc against a historically landmark building on which it was sitting was the central part of the expression. And here you see some of the three dimensionality that we talked about, each of these panels. There's a whole story about working to optimize the fabrication because everything was done at an extremely with an extremely limited budget, and how all of this was accomplished with a close association with the builders and material suppliers, etc. Most of these projects that you see, the actual fabrication drawings for all of these panels were all coming out of the architectural model, which continues to be an important part of SHoP's work. The idea of lighting integrated with the building and its transformation to different hours of day. Another example of using a traditional material in a non-traditional sense, facilitated by access to technological tools that were quite new and contemporary. It's basically a residential building in just near Houston Street, Soho. And the desire to have visual texture and three-dimensionality to a surface which was extremely limited by zoning regulations. Everything that you see in green was basically what was projecting beyond the property line, and could only project up to 3 3/4 of an inch. Of course, the desire to maximize the floor space area within, combined with learning about precasting concrete with a fascia, all of these things put together made it into quite a quite an interesting challenge. SHoP went on and developed not only the design idea, but the drawings that located every single piece of brick in a certain position and a certain orientation, which became the basis of CNC milling out molds where the bricks were laid and poured and cast into these panels, which eventually made the facade. Three-dimensionality, depth, traditional materials, use of technology, all of these things come back. Barclays Center in Brooklyn, the home of the basketball team, was completed in, I think, in 2012, and this was, in a way, the most significant project that SHoP has built so far, and also a very, very interesting culmination of everything that sort of had been within the process of working that had existed in the culture within there. It was sort of an interesting circumstance that SHoP found itself with a project of this significance. It was just after the 2008 financial crash. Frank Gehry's project for Atlantic Yards had to be abandoned because the client basically could not get it what it basically, the hole that you see in the middle is the actual arena, which was designed by Irving Beckett. It was actually an arena from a different city that kept the site. So it had basically been taken. The Forest City Raptor did not have any desire to go through the design process. They did not have any money to go through the design process of an arena. So they found an arena. They found something that they could put on the site. It just looked really bad. And they had, that is basically where SHoP came in. And SHoP developed the whole, the urban response of the, on the site, and it basically comprised of these products. And as early as schematic design, you know, they had a period of, from the time that, that the client first saw a rendering that was, I think, quite seductive, to the time that SHoP was asked to categorically state that they could do this in a certain time, a certain amount of money, was basically 2.5 months. And they were put directly in touch with the contractors, who gave them certain metrics for cost calculations. And there was this parametric model that basically used these three components, and it ran iterative development of various combinations to find the right combination of price and time to accomplish this. And that was basically what set the design of this thing, and that won them the project. So it was an extremely detailed sort of information driving design at an extremely early stage. And you know, tools that we are now extremely familiar with that a few years ago were less accessible were all employed. The idea of a wrapper, which is responding outwardly to the urbanity and inwardly to the program that is going on within, which was less under control of SHoP, was sort of a critical component of devising the transparency and the sort of blocking pattern that the facade has. And all of these pieces that you see here have tremendous amount of knowledge that sort of was brought into the model through direct collaborations with fabricators and with material manufacturers. The desire to accomplish it in Cortenz steel was another huge part of the challenge. And They were working with a consultant, a metal finishes consultant, who advised that it takes about 6.5 years for rust to form to reach the level of to reach the thickness of rust on Corten, which would be reliably long lasting, and they had about 4.5 months to fabricate. So the challenge became about creating 6.5 years worth of rust in 4.5 months, along with figuring out the actual integrity of, you know, getting something built. These are all drawings, fabrication level drawings done by SHoP to get this rolling. Basically, SHoP, once they got the architectural idea through, they were the only ones who held the data that could result the enclosure into being. And you know, basically every single piece that is on the facade was the fabrication drawings were developed within SHoP. The company that the finishing company that was going to apply this pre-weathering basically created a new facility, which was like a laundry shop, which had this continuous conveying rail on top, where each of these panels would hang, and they would constantly move, going through one room of spray jets that were spraying this chemical that were weathering it, and there were 12 times they would go through that spray jet in a day, and they would do this continuously for 4 months. actually there was, I mean, this was a huge database of information. Which panel, at what time, is weathered, to what extent, and you know, all of this, and you know, they basically developed this iPhone and handed out iPad touches to the workers to keep track of everything. It was kind of an exciting time. All of these complex geometries, all these shapes were designed, engineered, everything. Another challenge was getting all these unique, three-dimensionally unique shapes onto trucks and hoisted in the middle of Brooklyn. All in all, from start to finish, I think the project took 2.5 years, which was pretty amazing for what it achieved. And I think it has been a very successful project, both urbanistically for that area as well as for the arena within. This says 66 First Avenue. It is a project which is on the East River in Manhattan, on 30 and 36 streets. And this is the first project of SHoP's work with JDS, which is an exciting young development company that basically came out of nowhere, challenging the sort of the well-established real estate development agencies that dominate the New York City real estate scene. And it's really, this company is owned by two guys. One is 36 years old and the other is 34 years old. And these people basically came to SHoP. They walked in and said, "We want to see Greg Pasquarelli." And he's like, "Who are you? You have an appointment?" And they're like, "Well, we have a project." That's how it started. And it seems that there was a lot that they shared in their attempts to sort of subvert the status quo. So this was the first project which started out, it is a residential project, the L-shaped site basically drove the massing. And the desire to create something that was relatively unusual for its size, as well as sort of well integrated into a single project, even though there had to be two buildings, was sort of driving this. In sort of speculative real estate development is not an easy program to build for, because it has to, at some point or the other, come down to the lowest common denominator. You know, there's only so much, eventually you're not, unlike the beautiful Frank Lloyd Wright house we saw, which was catering to a family and a particular patron and a client who was looking for something very specific. Speculative real estate is built to appeal to the masses, so well, basically get occupied or acquired. So, to some extent, it is very oppressive in what it allows an architect to get away with, and there is a constant tug of war that happens between the desire to. By meaning into a building, either through form or through the facade, versus the strong sort of desire on the development and marketing side to maintain the uniformity of every single unit within. So what is interesting is that at some point, it was agreed that the building enclosure was going to provide not only a character for this, but it would continue to somehow change the character. So it had to be sort of a living facade, a changing facade. And but this slide basically indicates how the idea of a formal move starting to affect the facade. So the facade starts, the design of the building starts to heighten the sort of formal moves and somehow complement it further and, you know, further clarify the architectural idea. For me, facades are interesting because it is not about really designing a surface, or it is not about designing windows or enclosure. It is about developing an architectural language that will convey the architectural idea with some level of clarity, and the convey the conveyance of the architectural idea is accomplished through choosing of materials and choosing of a specific sequence of assembly, choosing of a specific, through identifying a clarity, the conceptual clarity drives creation of a value system for every project, which then drives how you make decisions about what materials and what kind of assemblies that that follow it. You're constantly asking yourself, does this further clarify the idea or does it diminish the idea? And that, you know, and that for me is sort of the most interesting part of working with materials on the building. So here you see this particular idea of the ripples created by the bridge is accomplished by varying the window sizes, and you know, this was a huge battle with the developers. They, you know, were not so keen on something like this, but I think at some point, after a lot of minor adjustments, it was agreed that this would be this way. And the idea of a living facade, the choice of copper as a material, which has been around for on roofs for a long time, but you seldom see flat tall surfaces made out of copper that would transform over time to something that is very, very different. And, this knowledge that this will happen to the material is welcomed, and it is an essential part of the ambition, the aspiration on both sides. Small scale mockups, etc., culminating into larger scale mockups that then get tested, etc. A lot of trips to factories, a lot of trips sourcing materials, etc. This project is now under construction and it's coming. I think it's already 5 stories out of the ground, and elements are starting to arrive at the site. So you guys should be seeing something soon. This says South Stream Seaport, Pier 17. It is one of the projects, one of the several projects SHoP is working on as a part of the South Stream Historic District redevelopment for a development company called Howard Hughes, which basically won the contract to develop it. The South Street Seaport, for people who do not know, it's on the sort of the eastern side of the tip of Manhattan, the southernmost tip of Manhattan. And the existing building was pretty severely damaged during Sandy. Several buildings in that area were pretty severely damaged, and that basically resulted in this effort to redevelop it, and SHoP won the master planning, and we are doing several buildings around there. This is a complete replacement. It's a brand new building that will be built exactly where South Street Seaport used to be. This area is a very tourist-centric area of downtown Manhattan. This is basically, South Street Seaport used to be sort of a big food and retail oriented facility, which was at the culmination of all the tourists going through the central business district, through Wall Street and Basically the pier itself, the quote unquote foundation of the gym before was also pretty severely damaged during Sandy. So the entire thing, including the pier, is being built ground up. It is right now under construction. Also, the pier is the piles are being drilled. So this project is essentially a retail slash food-oriented facility, as it used to be. What you see, the idea was to sort of, the previous building was quite monstrous and sort of red brick thing that was built in the 80s. It was very postmodern. It had these huge sloping green roofs on red brick, trying to look like a sort of turn of the century warehouse building in New York. And the idea was that we would try to bring some of the scale of spaces from sort of the traditional part of downtown Manhattan, which is right around here at the smaller scale, into this area. And it would eventually get topped by a much more organized retail component, and then punctuated by various points of visual connections and light, etc. And the idea of an enclosure, which again you see the themes of using glass for contrast, so that so that it stands in its contemporaneousness against the historic buildings around it. But at the same time, we decided to basically go to channel glass, which we all know Stephen Hall has used quite extensively in recent times. But it's also an extremely old cast glass technology. It is not a flat glass technology. But channel glass is yet not being utilized in a unitized grid mode system, and that was sort of where we were going with it, while trying to protect a level of three-dimensionality in it. So as you can see, there was sort of a pretty elaborate discussion with the client on how much depth was good enough, and of course, for us, the deeper the better. There are also these big gates that are meant to basically be floodgates, but they have to actually operate in order to let egress happen in case of fire and other such things. So the facade element that I'm talking about is basically these two things. It is these extremely three-dimensional channel glass components and this moving gate. This is a view of a mock-up that we completed right maybe about 8 months ago. What is interesting about this is that this entire height, which is two retail stories, it's about 35 odd feet of single grid mode units, which is quite unusually large, very, very long. You can see it somewhat here. A lot of the development of this unit, the glazing of the channel glass with all these temporary supports. Channel glass is not a very easy material to work with in long spans because it has very limited strength, and it cannot be subject to as much of strengthening as flat glass can be because of how it is made. And the entire thing was basically designed to stand vertically, but there was no way to glaze it vertically, so it had to be glazed horizontally, and that had its own challenges. Flow mock-up testing, etc., which we do on most of our projects, which basically brought us to a situation where we started understanding that the number of lights that were being expected to go into these cavities had to be doubled, or in some cases tripled, and these lights were actually bigger than we thought, and we went into an extremely detailed study of how we would provide maintenance access and light replacement access to this facade, and how that would work. Pretty elaborate. These are really complex sliding mechanisms, the folding sliding mechanisms that were being developed from scratch, just so that you would fit that many lights into very, very tight cavities. The project is, as I said, under construction, and hopefully there'll be something fun. 11 West 57th Street Tower. It is one of the most interesting projects going on in the office right now. It is also one of the new entrants on 57th Street, which was rezoned. But 2 minutes. It was rezoned by Bloomberg to sort of spur real estate development, and basically it allowed 57th Street to suddenly start receiving very, very tall buildings. And it follows sort of a history of very tall buildings in New York, which we're all very well aware of, which sort of in its earliest form was these buildings with setbacks, which was driven by zoning envelopes, and buildings that were limited by sort of the spans and access to materials, et cetera, which were the first generation of tall buildings in New York, which were then followed by these massive full block buildings that really could come into being because of the developments in air conditioning, et cetera. You know, really, really deep floor plates, which marked the sort of the second generation of tall building. And now we are here. We are here because partly because of the inflated residential market, which for the first time in history has usurped the position of the most expensive real estate. It was always corporate buildings or commercial buildings that were the most expensive real estate, and today that has turned itself upside down. All these super center towers are all residential buildings. So that is where this tower stands. It is 60 feet by 80 feet in its footprint, and it goes up, I did not say it, but about 1,400 feet. It is a super tall tower by its definition. The idea of old and new, the idea of familiar materials being given new identities is prevalent. Terracotta is something that you guys are all well aware of, which just like Buffalo exists in many corners in New York City. The idea of the zoning envelope forming, building massing, continues to define form for us even today in New York. And the strategy employed over here was to essentially break it down and really, really small setbacks as opposed to a few large setbacks. The specific position of this, where with the park to the north and downtown Manhattan to the south, midtown and downtown Manhattan to the south, gave a very clear actual priority, which located these two massive shear walls, which go from the bottom of the tower to the very top, essentially compensating for the slenderness in addition to the core, which is split in the middle. So the fact that the north and the south and south have to be very transparent was very clear. It was, and the fact that these sheer walls gave us an unusually blank canvas to populate with more interesting materials than glass sort of came as a relief. Basically, the plan, everything was driven by this axis and the organization. There's not much that you could do with it. So basically, the tower has a north facade, a south facade, and the east-west facades, which once again developing patterns on facade which heighten the formal moves is integral to the development of east-west facades, which gain these ripples from the setbacks. Of course, matter of a lot of attention and study. It is something that is accomplished by using changing profiles of extruded terracotta. Everything is an extruded. There are no cast pieces, but they step in profile. This sort of shows how there's a hinging point in this curve. When it comes out, it accompanies this curve, and then as it slowly steps in and turns into this curve, and this point sticks out. So it's sort of these two extreme points go in and out they basically go in and out to find those ripples. This is, for example, a foam mock-up that we have used quite extensively for not only understanding the level of setbacks that was acceptable, but also to understand the lighting effects, etc. This is a rendering. Cast bronze all the way up to 1400 feet as a decorative element is very much a part of this language of bronze and terracotta, both materials very, very commonly found in sort of 1920s, 30s architecture of New York City. The idea to bring them onto a very, very tall tower is sort of part of the whole familiar surprise element. We call it the filigree. The filigree itself was subject to many iterations, all of this culminating into about 200 feet of sort of a tower top cage structure, which is unoccupied except for the building maintenance equipment and some mechanical equipment. This project is also under construction now. We are already well past foundation work. We are starting to come out of the ground now. The facade is past visual mock-up. A lot of shop drawings are coming in right now. So that is it.
Our last speaker tonight is Ivar Sassen. So Ivar is a design director at Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, where he combines conceptual clarity with analytical processes using algorithmic tools and building performance modeling. He has designed complex institutional and commercial projects around the world, including the US Census Bureau headquarters in Maryland, Alhambra Tower in Kuwait, and Bacchara Hotel and Residence in New York City. He's teaching at Cornell University and also teaches at Pratt Institute at Northwestern University. He holds a Master of Architecture degree from Cornell University. Please welcome my first person.
Okay. You know, as we're tackling technology, let's get started. In Sapper's classification of architectural craft, into the tectonics of the lightweight frame and the stereotomics of heavy earthwork, SOM's most seminal work will comfortably belong in the following category. The firm pioneered the kit of parts construction method and created a modular, open, transparent, and well-crafted architectural language. Gwendolyn Wright, in her book, On the History of 20th Century American Architecture, writes, quote, curtain walls and open grid-based interiors became trademarks of Skidmore, Owings & Merrill, and New York's legal house assured their reputation for prestigious corporate statements, end quote. However, over 75 years of practice, SOM designers have explored beyond the bounds of corporate modernism, responding to diverse programmatic demands or project sites outside of the North American context. Some of these projects developed a strong stereotomic language that emerged from a different environmental or cultural context. Using Zamper's dichotomy of architectural craft, This presentation will attempt to introduce a stereotomic counterpoint to the historical narrative that narrowly places SOM's work under the Mesian modern language. My introduction. I am still black here. So, I can describe the projects, but you all know Lieber House from the history books, right? It's on the park area across from the Mises building. There's a steel plane. And it's a stick wall, curtain wall. It's one of the first examples of thinking of curtain wall that is enclosure that is actually not load bearing, it's sort of hung from the structure. It's lightweight. The images will help. Okay, so everybody walk up at least. Oh, this is very interesting. So we covered this part, concrete modernism. So we're not going to talk about concrete modernism today, but okay, for the reference, Lieber House, I love this picture because of that, this nice contrast between these cars and this building looks well ahead of the automotive industry at the time, not anymore. You can see the steel frame and the stick system in the historical drawing from Bruchstadt's time. Okay. More of the buildings that actually define what SOM is for like the historians and, you know, and these are great buildings, obviously. They all, this is all the SOM's offices at the Inland Steel Headquarters company. I mean, we don't wear ties anymore. it doesn't look like that, all right? Okay, stereotomic works. This is one of my favorite SOM buildings. The Pierce Solar Telescope, completed 1962, is an earthbound solution to a unique design problem. The functioning of the telescope requires a special environment devoid of exterior interferences. SOM architects and engineers submerge the telescope into the mountain to minimize solar heat interference and control lateral movements due to the gusting winds. Okay? This is digging into the ground. This is the essence of stereotomy now, right here. Now, above ground, the telescope consists of a tectonic frame clad in copper panels, which is that famous SHoP. And this is the telescope, actually, that's reflecting out there. And what is above ground is the form shaped by the trajectory of the earthbound light tunnel buried deep into the mountain. The conceptual similarities, the one on the right is one of my projects. The conceptual similarities between the Beinecke rare book and manuscript library at Yale on the left side, right, my right side, and the Al-Raji cube designed 2004 extend beyond the Euclidean monolithic prism that strongly defines their architectural expression. Both projects create an environmental shield to create moderated inner spaces. In the case of the Yale book, it's the rare book inside. In the projects, we have this sort of office building shielded by the monolithic walls. However, the construction technique of the shield differs. Beinecke Library's exterior is built by a steel frame clad in marble and infilled with translucent marble slabs, whereas Al-Raji Cube's exterior is designed to be a thick rampart structure. This sort of brings me to another favorite of my slides, to the National Commercial Bank in Jeddah. I'm going to stop reading. I'm just going to migrate. I like the way summer stands here. It's quite good. Okay, so two classic SOM buildings. The one on the right is Bruchstadt's Lust building. And I always wondered about this building, and I discovered this building actually when I started working at SOM just about 15 years ago. And I wondered where the windows are in this building. It was a fascinating skyscraper. It was built in 1982. I'm thinking, what was he thinking? You know, what is that sort of his last statement in architecture? He sort of erased all the things that you know of SOM, the module, the grid, the lightweight, etc. And if you, and I sort of start digging more, right? I mean, you can see the section, it's phenomenal. This is before the lead, this is before people are planning environmental design, etc. This was sort of like really defining how one should perhaps respond to the environment. not in an edited way, but in sort of a way that is, one could even say, low-tech. It's sort of very sort of ancient, in a way. You find a courtyard building. So I went and found this sketch in SOM's archives from 1977. You know, this diagram of an office building transforming itself to inside out. The center core building, you know, this is the formula that kind of SOM is responsible for creating. You know, the 45-foot lease span, the module, etc. And then, so turning the core and turning the building inside out to reach a floor plan, which is, this is a Chase Manhattan Bank, which is the typical office building, versus National Commercial Bank, which actually, you don't see any corner offices. The module actually hardly exists. There is no pyramid of offices. All the offices like these guys are inboard so that the light could travel. And there's a great level of transparency between looking through. This building fascinated me, actually. I have renovated it. I spent a lot of time in this building, looking at its structure and its, you know, look at the differences here. This is the lobby of National Commercial Bank. This is the lobby of Lever House. So if you were to say this is more of a museum, modern language, the one on the right is almost like a new calm modernism. It sort of looks like a museum. It's very enclosed. It's very shielded. There's a great deal of sort of, it's not about transparency. It's something more. And again, this is the classic SOM office looking out. This is the executive floor at National Commercial Bank. It looks like the courtyard. Okay, so now you look into these old construction pictures. Again, you've seen Lever House, one on the right, now the National Commercial Bank. The construction material of choice for the superstructure in those days was steel for office buildings. The concrete tall towers hasn't made a come yet. Now we do it. By then, at that point, people were, you know, the engineers sort of yielded to that. I mean, partly because you had to have, you know, these bridges, and you have to keep this part light. But it was also, I found this correspondence, basically, they weren't quite sure of the concrete pouring quality in these hot climates. So steel was a predictable choice. But then, something interesting happens. If you look closely, you see this pattern. It's very curious. Now, this is precast, okay? This is actually the substrate that is supporting the stone. And I was curious about this pattern, the jigsaw pattern. I have been there so many times, I've never seen this pattern in the stone. So I called up one of the retired architects in SOM that worked 55 years. And I went to his home, he opened the old drawings, and he explained to me why this is this way. Because you would never do a precast panel in this shape, unless you really want to show it as a pattern of choice. Right? I mean, in the last two presentations, we have seen phenomenal pattern making. But Bruscia wasn't after showing this because he collateralized this. And so you can see the pattern here versus the line, you know, this is the travertine slabs here that's collateral. That sort of seemed curious. So here's the construction of the documents dusted off. And you see the precast substrate there. So this is how it's interlocking. Now, like I said, never you would do this. You would do a simple rectilinear frame. Much easier. But he chose to do this because he wanted his building to have stone slabs that are staggered pattern. Because he wanted to do something that looked load-bearing. Contrary to the steel frame that is holding this up. Because his idea of stereotomy of that, he just really wanted the building to be masonry-like. And they went ahead and that sort of phenomenal pattern perhaps would be appealing to us now. We don't care about that. Like this image, you know, I'll just go back to that building. This image here might be appealing to the, you know, out here because, I mean, it's sort of attractive jigsaw pattern, and we do a lot of patterns these days. But he sort of wasn't interested in that, to the effect that he was only after a gentle staggering of the pattern of the travertine. And you know what? If you look at the actual travertine, unless you really, really carefully pay attention, the joint work isn't expressed that much. So actually, all you end up seeing here with this monolithic sheet of a building. It's really fascinating. Okay, I mean, how different is that from this? This is him, 30 years ago. This is what everybody knows is SOM. You know, the stack joint, the unitized wall, and this is what the Weinmark, for by and large, what curtain walls is. Okay, so this is where I started practicing at SOM. So these two buildings, I'm gonna just only talk about that. Same region, again, going back to this whole theory on stereochromy. It's about a response to really environment. And if you look at the floor plans of these three buildings, similar to the National Commercial Bank, we have explored in these two projects a decentralized core, protecting the floor plate from solar radiation. I'm a big believer of form driven by performance. I am not a signature architect, neither claim to be one. I would like to explain my ideas through performance. I'd like to calculate, I'd like to be able to claim that this actually works. This form has a performance aspect to it, like I said. Now, if you keep moving forward through, and I'm gonna get into this a little bit, and the context of this lecture being only about facade, so I'm gonna just stick to the facade bit of this building. But just bear with me for 1 second. The lobbies, again, in all these three projects have this sort of stereochromic quality of being solid and being sort of grounded back to the ground. It doesn't claim to look like a steel frame building. They are not. Alhambra Tower, designed in 2005, 6, and then construction land there. These buildings take some time to build. The form is really a response to the way the tower is oriented in Kuwait City. So we did it through various optimization algorithms. So basically, some of it is sort of intuitive. You know, the southern exposure, you really want to not expose yourself down there because there are a lot of perimeter loads coming from that. And on the northern side, where there are views, they want the glass, they don't want the glass here. So then the way the core works, and the way the irregularity of the edge sort of helps from a structural performance point of view, confusing the winds. So this is where the site is located. The peninsula, this is what the building looks like. Again, this is just a similar formal transformation and a larger floor plan of Alhambra Tower here. Okay, so that here, we went ahead and used concrete. Again, this is 21st century. We are, you know, the concrete is caught up and it's actually pretty reliable. And in fact, concrete there is much better than pouring concrete here. So there is great expertise in pouring high-strength concrete in some parts of the world. And this, we just realized we should take advantage of that. And this building wants to be in concrete, and it is in concrete. The definition of the walls are paraboloids, which is really important because these straight lines are what defines the cores of the jump form system, okay? A high-rise building is designed like a machine. It has to be done, each floor has to be poured every 4 or 5 days. If you're like spending a lot of time for each floor to be crafting it, then you can't build this kind of an idea. So you have to invent a machine that could climb and pour these just like it is doing it on straight walls. That is key. And the key to that is a clear geometric definition. Okay. So these are all point clouds that define this, that was fed to the former contractor. This is actually their drawing of the former that is the shear wall looking up. Okay. This thing is like 420 meters almost tall. That's same height as Empire State. And standing up there is quite nice. Southport. Okay, so another shot, and this is sort of after the cladding. Now, I'm only showing this, I didn't take this picture, but I have seen this building, and I have seen similar buildings, and actually, in fact, Nian mentioned a window where you see without being seen, this sort of notion of privacy. I mean, these windows were designed, thick windows, for that reason. I mean, they're all on doorways and you look down before, you know, the guy doesn't see who's coming. And so there's sort of sense of privacy, but also the way the light is controlled. So this idea I explored in this project, which you briefly saw the slide of, is creating, and this building was designed to be a ramped earth wall. So this wall is 80 meters tall, and that at the base, it's like 6 meters thick. So, you know, we just said, well, if we have a thick wall, why not just do something? You know, I'm not actually, I don't like working on that one. So I thought that why not just sort of go in there and cut into this thick wall. So we came up with this idea of small little windows connecting to larger windows inside. I mean, for, so that way, actually, this thickness could be sort of cut into incision, this idea of cutting. Again, stereotomy sort of roots is about stone cutting, right? The art of stone cutting. So that sort of working your way is cutting into. So these are some of the ideas of how the inside is shaped of that same thing. Now, this project got quite far, but didn't get built. But I took this idea to recycle it when we were thinking about cutting into the deep shear walls of Alhambra. These walls are 1.5 meters thick. And again, these are the diaphragm walls that are holding up the tower. So the idea was that when you come off the elevator lobby in each floor, you would get a framed view of Quake City, like as if every view is sort of projected back into that window frame. But basically what we did is we chopped these walls. The angle of each wall is different. And it's sort of referring back to this level. So when you go out to the elevator lobby, you see Quake. When you're walking along the side, you don't see anything. You just see lights coming through this wall, which is incredibly thick. And again, there is an honesty of what is structure, and the cladding follows the structure. It doesn't try to be anything other than what the structure is. And this is, when you look up, you can see how different this window and that is, because that angle here is different, like that plan that I showed you. So this is looking up on the tower. Now, similar to the challenges Bunshaft had, we had our own obsessions with how the stone should be clad over the concrete. In this case, it's not precast, it's cast-in-place concrete. So on the hyperboloid walls, the doubly curved walls, we chose to use a different method, which would sort of to term trancheus, which is basically a stone mosaic. If like directly on concrete, we had to do a lot of analysis to make sure that the differential movement between concrete and the stone work together, so we don't have stone falling up over it. But see, these guys are hand applying. This is almost like artisanal way of putting that stone on that wall, which sort of looks like this. This is actually not the floor, this is the wall. Okay, so you're looking up that. So this is pieces of stone. Now, sort of like the ground, isn't it? Like, there is that sort of notion, perhaps, that this face is looking back to the desert, that sort of has that further reading. But as an architect or designer of the building, I wouldn't make that reading. I would let the historian or the critique read into this. But there is that cue, however, after the fact that as I was thinking about the topic and the topics, the keywords came up with this symposium, I pulled this image. And I also pulled this mosaic at the dome of the rock. And the sort of notion that artisanal mosaic covering is very much in, you know, in the culture of the Middle East. So we sort of, perhaps, you know, just like one shot sort of staggering of stereotyping, we were thinking of tile and stone in a way where it has some references, the way we would like to define that. So that's looking up that building. I'll just touch a little bit on the lobby because I really, really like this piece a lot. And also because how tall buildings meet the ground is a challenge. Because everybody wants a piece of the ground floor plan. Everybody comes in there. Like, this is as crowded as Grand Central Station, except it doesn't have that sort of grand Central Station. But you you want to create a grandness, unless you have sight, how would you do that? Right, you have a building that is 412 meters tall, 80 floors, and you need to, the structural engineer wants all the area he wants, he can, because it's the root of the tree, right? All the elevators open, all the infrastructure comes in. So how do you create a public space that has grandness in it? So this really concrete lamella structure, this is all cast in place concrete. There's no fake coverage here, there's no fake ceiling, it's poured in place concrete, all defined, all structural. This is this entire branching system that supports the tower. Basically, when you go up, and this is the digital project model of the lamella, SOM's engineers work with us directly on this. And again, I have a lot of analysis on this, but I'm gonna save the thing. These are the definition of the drawings. This is the model, this is under construction, and another construction shot. So basically, everything you see here is structural. And when you walk in this lobby, there is this sort of sense of grandness that comes with the resolution of the forces. Okay? So that beauty of pattern is what the forces are. This is almost the natural flow of how the building meets the ground. Thank you very much.
Okay, so we're gonna, those of you who are still here, we're going to have a brief question and answer, but just after we have a discussion up here with the presenters. And we're just waiting on one more to come back. But maybe just to get, I think actually in many ways, Ivar has already answered the question that I was going to ask. I guess that's the risk of preparing one more thought. But just to get started on that, I'd like to start the conversation on a more general topic of aesthetics. And of course, you can approach this in a variety of ways. You've seen a variety of projects. I'm sure each one has its own particular stories and its own particular goals with regard to the topic. But more generally speaking, how might you define aesthetics as a practice, or how might you edit that? As an example, and I think I've already spoke to this a little bit, but as an example, Freud also spoke to aesthetics in his work as something that appeared naturally or suddenly, of course, through the formalized process, the unbelievably rigorous process that it was. And but the spirit of that, I think, is inspiring the question. How do you define and evidence aesthetics if I was evidencing it through structure and physics? Where do you find in general, let's say, topic of aesthetics placed in your practice?
I'm personally interested in the aesthetics of the craft, of the specific processes or specific steps of assemblage of material or of the material coming into being, imparting a certain distinctifying character or a certain identifiable idea of a part contributing to sort of the overall reading in a way.
is sort of, you know, the image and representation is really important to the work that we do, and it's sort of like a major vehicle as such to sort of develop ideas. And, you know, for me, with my sort of post at the office, it's oftentimes sort of looking at the performative aspects of what the facade needs to do, what materials. And these are constantly sort of chasing this sort of greater vision as seemingly disparate sort of forces or considerations start to inform what the sort of visual aesthetic or outer appearance of these facades and facades are.
I already mentioned you in the question, actually, because your comments about the, you know, wall, the facade is the structure, it's not trying to be anything else, is more or less what I asked, which is, I brought up the topic of aesthetics in a general conversation. There was examples that have been drawn out, I think, through all the, there were moments in each of the presentations that spoke to, let's say, the idea of aesthetics as something that happens naturally in the process. And so I just wanted to know, but then there was a moment in yours also where you said, you know, the punch at the jigsaw, where actually the whole purpose of that was to arrive at something that looked like it was low brain, you know, which is actually, I guess, contrast to what you were saying about the alarm hotel.
The topic of aesthetics making you uncomfortable. I think it's a great topic for education. Aesthetics and Kant and Hegel and what have you, but for a designer, I feel comfortable. But I can say, and also, for, I am also uncomfortable with facades too, and coming from a restaurant. So, as a, you know, because I really don't like that idea that we dress up stuff. Okay. I mean, that's my take on this. I think, I sort of believe in a kind of maybe a, I would say, stubborn in modern way of thinking that there is sort of an ethos in architecture where there's that some level of relationship between what happens, of what it is, and how it projects itself. So I really don't care too much about the image of it. So that sort of, if the facade is projecting an image, again, that makes me uncomfortable. So I think, you know, Bunschaft, I mean, I find, okay, so with having said that, you know, a lot of people would say, well, Corbusier didn't draw elevations, and I mean, which isn't true, right? I mean, there's a sense of proportion, a lot of things, and there are, we draw elevations, I look at the facades, you know, and I make sure that, you know, there is a sense of proportion on that, you know, in, as you're executing these things. So the Bunschaft's choice of kind of challenging this stack to a stagger is as much a position for like how all the curtain wall construction was to, as whether it looks load-bearing or not. I mean, frankly, when you're there, you don't barely see that jointing. I mean, you see one sheet of stone. Like I said, I spent a lot of time in that building. I renovated the building. I mean, I was shocked to even discover that, you know, that little detail that he sort of put in there. So, and I wouldn't have put that cracked earth image because of, I just said I should like do something about the lecture. There's a couple of keywords that, you know, like every time I look at that image, everyone says, is this the floor or is this the, you know, and so I was like, okay, well, why not just let's put a floor in it. So that was really.
We have 4 seconds.
It's my turn to sit now. So one more question, and then we'll open it up to the audience if anyone would like to ask this group of speakers a question. So maybe the reverse of Nick's question, it's a bit about function and material. So something I was observing in all three of the talks was that each office and each speaker is trying to, in their own way, redefine potentially what a facade is as to something that you can walk on or something that's ground, or something that becomes so thick it becomes a space in and of itself. And there were many, many examples that spanned across the three talks, and what's its role as part of the structure, what's a facade that doesn't actually separate inside and outside, or a facade that has no program beyond it or behind it. There were many, and some were shared and some were different based on the work of these three offices. So I guess I was wondering, and in each office tended to break the rules or rewrite the equation for the development of the facade. So this question of rewriting the game, I was kind of interested in how each office tends to tackle that problem from the use of technology or changing the workflow within the office in order to deliver or to achieve a certain goal. So how do you measure, and then ultimately, after playing the game, how do you measure the success in a project? What's the gauge or what's the level of measurement that each of you deem the project to be successful once it's completed? So it could be performance driven, it could be material driven, it could be ultimately aesthetic driven, but if you can comment on that, I'd like to hear from each of you.
The second one, how do you find it successful? I think it's not my job to find it successful or not. I think there's, some people, there is the critique, the role of the critique. You can find it successful, some do, some don't. In any given of these buildings, you can. You can look at any architect's work, you can get a whole critical discussion about it. I'm not quite sure. An architect can participate in that to some level, but you need that sort of critical distance. And when does that critical distance occur, right? It's not right after the work finished, for sure. So I can't just walk off a job and say, geez, that was a great building. I always say that. Not if that's sort of satisfaction, wow, we did it again. But okay, so but then, what does that mean? It means really, but then you start theorizing. Like after 15 years, I wrote this this book about stereotomy and SOM, which, is something that I wasn't thinking about along the way. Right? So theorizing to me has to come, you need that sort of distance a little bit and sort of look back and say, okay, all these years I've done all this work in a firm that's got about 75, 80 years of history, so I played a piece of that history. So what does that mean? So to me that theorizing doesn't necessarily come specific to the job, but it has to kind of distance yourself.
Well, I think for me personally, it partly comes from our focuses. I think my focus primarily in the office is a technical function, but a lot of that has to do with for me really looking at the performative aspects of the facade in many ways. Sort of, in a sense, achieve the design intent, but yet at the same time strengthen that design intent. And oftentimes, I think there's a whole host of considerations you have to take into account for the facade, whether that's sort of solar performance, technical aspects such as the structural sort of makeup of that facade, but ultimately, in the end, it's what I sort of see as the ultimate success for the facade is one that can sort of address the larger idea of what the facade is really trying to achieve from a design standpoint, but at the same time have the a sort of like underlying efficiency to the way that it's built. And to me, there's no, I spend a lot of time in sort of detailed design, and oftentimes, we run into separation between design and technical field. And to me, with sort of the detail, there is no, in a successful detail, there's no separation of sort of design and technical.
starts very, very early on. It is a constant process of deliberation to find what is. It is not that dissimilar from a poet who spends days on a couplet trying to find just the right order of words to say exactly what they're trying to say. I think that we all, as we start off on a project, through agencies that we're working with, or through things that are important to ourselves, we define for each project sort of a value system, which we constantly use as a reference as we develop what exactly we want this project to talk about or to convey. Every step of the process, whether a visit to a factory in late CA could suddenly reveal to you something about material where you would have to revisit things that you thought were important to you, and find other strategies that you thought were appropriate, because you're constantly receiving, you're constantly learning from all sorts of directions. It is like tuning the radio. You're fiddling with it for the longest time.
In all three presentations, there was at least a little moment where it was touched on some kind of cultural knowledge or material specialization that either existed and you didn't know about it, or existed and it was used, or it didn't exist and you really needed it. I think specifically in Stan's case with the concrete or high performance concrete shop, it seems to be more built into the actual practice of how design actually happens. Your explanation with dialing in the radio signal kind of speaks to that a little bit. But I'm curious as to how some of these things fall into the projects themselves, whether there's sort of a oh shit moment where you realize some problem is happening and there's some concern where you have to make a creative design move and try and be a warrior for whatever concept you were trying to carry through. Or then there, in some cases, there's a, I guess, this may be more directed towards shop again, but perhaps with the mosaic tiles in the SOM project, there's sort of a knowledge before the design happens or before while it's happening where you can say, well, we'll let them propose something, or let somebody who knows something about how people build in this part of the world or how people in this industry work. So I was wondering if you could just talk a little bit about how those moments happen and how those crossovers between architecture and trade happen.
Every project is a story, right? Every project is something that defines the flavor of the project, which sort of goes, which sort of overrides every other experience on that project. And sometimes the project is defined by a specific persuasion of a client who would not have certain things in a certain way, which drives a lot of activity. Sometimes it is what you discover underneath the ground. Sometimes it is what you discover on the shop floor of a, where something is being made. So yes, I think oh shit moments are quite common. They happen more often than any of us would like. They define a lot of what you learn from something. They define a lot of what you end up accomplishing. And that is what keeps it interesting.
Can I add something to the ocean moment? I think there are a couple of types of ocean moments, but there's the one type where you just sort of realize you're solving the wrong problem. See, that fundamentally is different. And I would urge all designers in-house to ask because sometimes that why, you know, is an ontological sort of existence right there to tell you, no, you shouldn't bother. It's like this sort of American pragmatism. So it's like, why would you bother doing this? You know, just, I sometimes all shit comes to me like that, but like there is that sort of level of, yeah, I mean, that's at a design level. And you sort of have to ask yourself that question. On sort of things, on the practical level, everything we do here, and every architect does it, is bespoke, right? In a site, like it's like a custom, everything is unique. People that you design for everything. So there's many offshoot moments for that matter, right? You know, but things always go wrong, and they do. And it's part of the fun, we all like that, that's that.
Yeah, no, I mean, that's, I think that's a great question, and it might, you know, in my case, in the tower example, I think it fits really in with the aesthetic, because, you know, I mean, we had a larger idea of exploring opacity for one. There's some notion for whatever reason that it's somewhat red, you know. There's no sort of, these are sort of intuitive moves, and I think one has to kind of address sort of like Ivar's saying, you know, ask the right questions. So what is the right material? Well, ultra high performance concrete because of its flexural strength at 3 times out of normal concrete, or its high compressive strength. Its high durability to resistance to pollution. Like, so these things kind of occur, and you're really always kind of gauging the landscape as far as you're developing the design. Finding these sort of synchronicities that sort of inform one of the next question, maybe the next step. And a lot of it then becomes sort of strategic. You know the client's going to attack certain aspects of the design. So then I think it just kind of begs the question, well, you already know it's coming, so what's the sort of thesis that has to survive? And then what are sort of the options that are acceptable? And I think through all that, you really start to get to what the project really is. I mean, if we knew what the project was at the beginning, there would almost be no point in doing it at the end. So,
thank you. So, this question is really actually all anyone can answer. Some sort of notion that building angle becomes kind of the last remaining area of an architect kind of involved more aggressively because typically, architect's job start from the developer chart, and then, for example, Alejandro argued that like, how much structural innovation you can do for the new project, and how much messing can improve based on the certain tight competition and kind of global economy. So that leads to architect like, having the responsibility of the design the envelope in terms of creating the street, the identity of the street, the image of the city. Those tasks are being more and more converged into the task of design and building envelope. So, Ivar's, our discussion and the logic behind it is the Arlanda Tower is actually kind of the only one I can think of which is against to that notion that it tried to innovate the structure, it tried to involve everything together. But what do you think? Do you agree? These contenders of the contemporary business, contemporary building construction industry, and architect is how much architect can kind of get out of that situation. I mean, Ivar, you know that most of the SOM towers, most of the SOM towers is kind of can get out of that notion, as you know.
Okay, well, without going into the controversial land here, I'm just going to say, if you were to say what you said in the first paragraph, that the facades being the architect's only sort of design realm, I think that's a very sad state of affairs, I would say. Like, that would be really, really sad. I would quit architecture and go to fashion, because, you know, frankly, you can design something every 3 months, you don't have to deal with leakage, whatever, but, you know, that can't be that. I would resist to, in any condition, and it is not. And especially in the world that we live today, where the built environment makes such a big difference, we all have a moral responsibility of all to actually come up with designs that respond to the challenges that the Earth is looking for us to come up with. Okay? So like 2014 was the warmest year ever recorded, the New York Times. 1997 till today, the 10 warmest years ever recorded happened between 97 to today. So, you know, leaving all that behind and saying that if this facade is pretty or not, to me, is really a ridiculous question.
Well, I think it just points to sort of, I guess, the question is really asking, you know, how do we inject integrity into the facade? Or like, what is really forming this thing? And once again, it's not one certain force or one consideration that is really driving it. I mean, you always, you know, each project, Tom kind of has an idea about things that he wishes to address, wish to acknowledge or challenge. These might be typological concerns, social agendas, or some sort of effect with the facade or whatnot. Really sort of kind of trying to build an idea and developing it, but actually responding to a multitude of influences. So a lot of the facades that we do, they do appear to have sort of like almost a very intuitive image or pattern-like quality to them, but they all strive to sort of be resultant or almost sort of very integrated with the space beyond. So at times the space is sort of just wrapped with the facade, other times it's sort of an inverse sort of effect. But you know, to me it's sort of injecting this sort of performance, whether it's client satisfaction performance, a technical performance, or you know, just a greater sort of attention to what the facade is actually doing.
I think that I feel for your question. I think that it is a very relevant question to ask ourselves, because there is so much. I mean, the fact that you are having a facade symposium here, there is so much attention to the building enclosure that is, you know, at every level of architectural discourse. I think it is partly true, but I would say that it is nuanced by somewhat the context in which a building is happening, whether it is the programmatic or the typological context. As I referred to during my presentation, when we come to sort of speculative real estate development, where large, and you know, that mode of production is right now a highly prevalent mode. A large part of our built environment is being built by people who will not use it. You know, the clients are people who are not building their own homes, they're not building their own offices. They're building it as a neutral space that will be given away to someone else. And a large part of us are occupying spaces that we have no say in when they were being built. And I think that particular mode of production does become oppressive in sort of stripping away several opportunities that might otherwise, you know, in a project that, for example, if you were to build an office building for as a headquarter for a specific client, it is a slightly different flavor than building an office building for sort of commercial rental or leasable space. And you know, there is something to be said over there, but the fact still is that even for a speculative real estate project, if you have a team of 8 people, there will be one person working this out, right? There is a lot of work that goes into building a project design. Facade, of course, is where probably a large, like, proportionately large amount of money is spent on it, and because it is the identity and it is the, it is everything that we know it is. But there is a lot of, I don't even think that, I've worked specifically in facade and I know that I'm doing a very small part of the project. I think there's a lot of work at every level.
So hi, this is Aniket, and thank you for the wonderful presentation. my question is, how do you manage to maintain those initial concepts and ideas when it comes to cost cutting or like value engineering? I know this question is quite general and quite situation related, but then I would like to know your 11th hour discussion about these issues and how to solve these issues maintaining your basic concept as it is.
Yeah, you know, I walked away because my boss was calling me because he's writing this email to a client who would not accept what we really want in our design. It's an ongoing process. It is happening all the time. I think that I don't have an easy answer to that. Everything goes through EE, everything goes through some level of tug and more. It comes down to what kind of a client you have, right? And how aligned are your sense of values with their sense of values. The better projects come out of partnerships that are better aligned than others. And I think every one of us are working on projects where there's good alignment and there's not so good alignment.
Well, I think there's quite a lot of time and development that goes on from initial concept through to the built form, but I mean, we are constantly trying to actually take the client needs and actually embed that so much into the design as a whole that you know, even if certain things get stripped away or they have to modify, you still are left with the essence of sort of this design intent that you want. And there are times when things are actually quite divisive and strategic. In the sense that in the case of this tower, where we knew there was probably little to no hope that we would get ultra-high performance concrete in China. By the time we got to looking at alternates, it became clear to us that the natural alternative, glass fiber reinforced concrete, was in such a poor state of industry standard there that that wasn't even an option. So we knew well ahead that we would probably need to substitute material at some point, or at least offer up suggestions. But of course, you know, there's strategy in that. We didn't want to sort of even offer that up until we knew what that really was, for an example. And I think anyone to look at that building would say, well, why isn't it metal? And so then that's kind of like the sort of the process you have to go to and sort of weigh what's important to the design. There are times when there's quite a bit of strategy involved. And sure enough, once we did offer up a sort of suggestion, well, it could be metal, and immediately, oh, okay, it's metal. You know, there was no negotiation. So, but by that time, you've already vetted the sort of options and how you can actually integrate that into the design. And I think that's part of that's a large part of sort of design. You know, sort of the rationalization. Justification of what the design is involved in.
So I wonder, we've touched upon this throughout everyone's presentation.
icing on the cake. It's not like you just sort of, or it's even more, it's not like you design something and you like it, and you give it another entity and say, now optimize this form, make it buildable for me, right? So that isn't what I'm talking about. I'm saying that I'd like to find a form that checks the attributes that you want it to check, right? So there's different things, because you can build anything. If you have all the money, all the time in the world, you can, right? It's possible, and it's been proven. Whether it should be built or not is a different discussion, but you can. The question is, the genesis of this form, is it tied to real attributes that you want to tie it to? Like if you're designing a super tall building, and if you're not talking to a structural engineer, well, you're making right there a big mistake. This is not something you can give him the plan and say, get me some shear walls wherever you can fit. Because I have a great facade. Well, okay, that's exactly what I'm trying to, you know, contrary. And if you're doing a wind optimization, well, you're going into the tunnel. You're going into the tunnel and you're transforming the building. And as an architect, you should be able to say, well, this form performs better and I'm going to go with that. I mean, you have to be in that table, right? Like whether than telling the engineer, you put more rebars there, or stick some more. Like, I mean, that's the difference between, you can enable it, you can, at this time, on the level of being excessive, okay? So you can do anything. But the question is, should you? And my design philosophy is that if I want to do something that is performance driven, all the performance attributes, mechanical engineer, if whoever those people are, and you should pick them, and you meet with them as early as you can, because the differences are made in a project early in the game. Later on, everything you add is additive. You know, you're just basically fixing a problem that you shouldn't have created in the first place.
No, that's well put. I mean, I think the three projects I show have, every project clearly has drivers over the moment. I mean, the first project I showed is almost like a biomorphic sort of organization of space. The concern is not efficiency at all. He ticks the boxes off by sort of, you know, where we can sort of maximize on the sort of geometry and sort of weave into the narrative a sort of sustainability or some part of strength. But you know, the first project was largely compositional and sort of more about sort of the sort of unpredictable happen chances that could occur with the spaces. You know, the second project was clearly a response to the client's conservative wants and needs for the town. You know, and wherever you can, you sort of interject the sort of the drivers that are important to how you feel the design. And other times, we have forms which are very didactic in the sense that they're really, really informed almost like in some similar way, like in the form of fatality that Ivar shows. But there's, I think what Ivar is talking about is this sort of a holistic approach and sort of the purity to design that comes from you know, considering a whole host of, sort of considerations. I guess that's
I think all the projects that we are presenting here and that we work on of a level of the scale and complexity of these projects, they are orchestral pieces, they're not solos. They come into being through the accretion of information from many, many different sources and happens throughout this process. The architects do find ourselves sort of in a conductor role many times, where we are ensuring that everyone is on the right time cycle and that everyone is, you know, producing and answering the questions that need to be answered at that time and all of that. Majority of these projects would not come into being if that were not the case. I think that my working experience, I have played both the roles of sort of a consultant to an architect as well as of an architect who is working with consultants. And there are, again, you know, for each project there is a set of, you know, based on the client and their aspiration, based on sort of the aspiration of the architectural design intent and all of that, there are things that gain a greater value which become untouchables in a project, or there are other things that, you know, which happens. But for the most part, things are decided based on negotiation. And completely agreeing with what I was saying, I don't think that that projects of such scale and complexity can be accomplished without that.
All right. I'd like to thank Samir, Stan, and Ibars for three really great talks and great discussion after. So if you